Welcome to a new test and teardown video. It looks like I got another station monitor. This time it's a Kenwood Station Monitor SM220. It looks a lot like the Heath kit I played with yesterday. It's like more or less all the same kind of features, a little bit more sweep kind of things here and stuff like that, a little bit more different tones. Yeah, it got a little bit more of everything and it looks a lot newer because it's all plastic and that kind of stuff. It's a little bit rusty. Somebody forgot this in the backyard, I guess. This one is also monitoring power amplifiers and radio stations and stuff like that. But I think here it's already wired up for, see, he says drive, input, output, so those two will be connected together. So this is the input to your power amplifier, and this is the output of your power amplifier, and then it goes to your antenna. And that means it will be able to see if your power amplifier is not linear, or if it's clipping and something like that. Because you want to drive the amplifier to its maximum potential, but you don't want to create harmonics or like real heavy clipping. So that is what this monitor can show you. Because it's really rusty and all this kind of thing, I think I should take off the lid before I power it up so I can just see what to expect. So we are inside here and it is a little bit dirty and stuff. I don't know, what do you think about that? Yikes. So I need to go and give this a little bit of compressed air. Then it's gonna be nice to work with. This is not so funny because I really, yike. But anyway, you see the transformer is angled in a really weird angle. At first glance, this looks weird, but the magnetic field of this transformer is obviously a problem to the CRT. So at this special angle, the problem is as low as it can be at this distance. Otherwise, you could put it here at the back, you know, but that will make the case bigger, right? So yeah, in here we got the power couplers and obviously some different filters and functions and RF attenuators and stuff like that. And when I dial this, of course dial this one, right? Ooh yeah, look at that. I see some cracks in the white plastic right there, right? And the other one, when I dial this, nothing happens. That's because it just spins. We got a little bit weird light here. It's just because it spins around here. So if I grab it here, okay, it works. So I should just tighten those set screws. Ooh, it's also loose in that one. Yeah, so there's a little bit of fixy-fixy here, and then I will do that, and then clean it up, and then we'll get back to testing. What is inside this one? Why is this inside a... Oh, that's probably some sweep and oscillators and time bases and stuff like that. We don't want to... Where's the sweep stuff? That is probably time bases, right? Oh no, yeah, maybe. So what is in here? Interesting. No loose parts. I'm waiting for the glue while I'm fixing this. I mean, I might as well just have a little bit of a look. What is inside the power couplers here? And I see they're connected also to the... I mean, that will be the deflection, right? And all sorts of other wires going in and out of all sorts of goody thingies here, right? Well, that is very complicated here. So, let's just open this box and see. So this is the coupler unit, and obviously they tried to make good impedance between this, so they made a really wide track here between the connectors, and all that is pretty good. And there's another wall in here, there's a resistor connecting to the output, and the drive, there's a white wire. Where's that going? There's a... another little plate in here that goes... Oh man, we need to remove that screw and... Okay, of course we need to remove those two pots. And we got two other screws up there. Not that easy to get in here, really. That was funny. So I took out that plate. And now we can see what's going on in here. We're only going to have a tiny little sneaky peek of the two switches, some resistors and diodes and good stuff down there, and then different capacitors on that pot, and that is the RF attenuation. So that means different values, lower values. Okay, so it can handle more power. That's kind of the way that it just couples via different capacitors. And the other one, the white wire, goes again to some other resistors and some diodes and stuff. Okay. So that's quite interesting. A little bit weird that those wires, they're not with capacitors or DC blocking or any kind of RF filtration or anything. It's just all over the place like that. How good is that going to be? Well. Why can't this be good down there? It's something to do with... Okay, that's better. It's just impossible for me to get a good sharp picture of this. So, after a deep clean with a paintbrush and compressed air and all that, this unit is really, really nice and clean again. Compressed air is really, really good to go all the way deep between all the components. And sometimes my paintbrush is just loosening and preparing stuff to get blown away. So I think that combination is really, really a good success. I took off the bottom plate as well, so we can have a deeper look on the bottom here as well. Oops. I really think this unit was in use for quite some years, because you see some dark areas here, and this takes quite a lot of time. You also see some modifications and even marked areas for possible modifications. Look at that. So it's maybe the resistor was intended to go here, or either open or a resistor, and then hey, we need this wire there instead. And so I also fixed the two broken nylon parts right here. Well, fixed, I actually just took them apart and cleaned them up and put in some 10-second glue and then put it all together and screwed it together when the glue was still wet. And now it works really nice and stable. I can turn the switches here, and so I think I'm ready to power this up and see if there's any funny sounds or smells or anything good inside this unit. I am now powering this unit up for the first time. Mains is applied, and let's try and push the... Ooh, we got red light. 20 watts is quite normal, I would guess. We don't... Yes, we do see a line. Yeah, look at that. Wow, that is nice, and it's good in focus. Still about 19 watts. Let's see if this works. Oh, that's a little bit of... I can smell a little bit of... So that is vertical gain. I should try and put some input. And let's see about the sweep. Is this... Yes, it is indeed responding to that. Yes, exactly. Uh-huh. Sync scan marker with... Oh, that's quite interesting. But it looks like it's alive. So here we go with an input of 1 kilohertz. And it looks like... It is really working well. Got a little bit of loose contacts, obviously, but it is really working. It looks like it's actually... Yeah, there's a trigger. So in RTTY mode, it's actually triggering on the input signal, and I think this is kind of the trick of that sweep. How we can prove if that is correct is to change the input to... Yes, we're changing a few hertz of input, so that is okay. Let's go all the way to 1 kilohertz and then 2 kilohertz, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so there, of course this is not a real scope with everything like that, but I mean, this is 10 kilohertz, and then we can probably just... Okay, so that's kind of how it is. External, so this is external horizontal. Horizontal is here. Let's try and do that. So yes, of course it also works in external sync. So all you have to do is put it into RTTY external. I think this one is a salt. Yes, indeed. Here we go. So yes, I think this unit really works. That is really great. Thank you very much for watching. See you again tomorrow.